Nations to come together in one mind and one accord, and let us worship the Lord together. Let's stand and let's magnify the Lord with me. Let us worship His name together. Let's just invite the Lord's presence into the service today. Father God, we come before Your presence with thanksgiving. We enter to Your courts with praise, Lord. Father, Lord, we thank You for these congregations that have come together in one mind and one accord tonight. We come together to worship You and to praise You and to magnify You and to glorify You. Father, Lord, let us magnify You and let us to worship You and praise You tonight. Father, Lord, we pray that You bless every part of the service tonight. Bless all the participants in the service, the singers, the drama, the skits. Father, Lord, bless the pastor from Apopka as he preaches to us tonight, Lord. Father, Lord, just anoint and empower and bless tonight, Lord. And Father God, we give You the thanks and the praise in the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Worship the Lord as the Violin Road Praise Team leads us in worship tonight. Remain standing.
Thank You, Jesus. Amen. I'm on. Amen. Amen. Can you hear me? Amen. God bless. It's good to be in the house, Lord, and I'm good to be here to worship with y'all. Amen. The song's a little newer, but I couldn't get the words out of my head this afternoon, so let's worship and hopefully y'all know it.
He became sin. Who knew no sin, that He might become His righteousness? He humbled Himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Messiah, His name above all names, His blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all, Jesus Messiah, He's the name above all names, blessed be
for sinners.
Messiah, the name above all names, the blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel. He's the rescue for sinners and the ransom from hell. Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.
Hallelujah. His body the bread, his blood the wine, it was broken and poured for all of the whole earth trembled and the veil was torn.
Messiah, the name above all names, the blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, oh, the rescue for sinners, and the ransom from heaven, oh Jesus Messiah, the Lord of all.
One more time, let's worship him tonight. Hallelujah.
Jesus Messiah, he's the name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, and the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, the Lord of all.
Let's worship tonight. Hallelujah. Oh, he's our Jesus Messiah tonight. Oh, his name above all names. He is our Emmanuel. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, I'm so glad I have a Savior to talk to, someone to go to in a time of need. Amen. Let's sing this old one together.
I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in, and then a little light from heaven filled my soul. Well, it bathed my heart in love and wrote my name above, and just a little talk with Jesus makes me whole. Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all about our trouble. He will hear our faintest cry. He will answer by and by. Now when you feel the prayer will turn it, then you'll know a little fire is burning. You find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Sometimes our path seems drear without a ray of cheer, and a cloud of doubt may hide the light of day. The mist of sin may rise and hide the starry sky, but just a little talk with Jesus clears the way.
Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all about our trouble. He will hear our faintest cry. He will answer by and by. Now when you feel the prayer will turning, and you know the fire is burning, you will find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
I may have doubts and fears, my eyes may fill with tears, but Jesus is a friend who watches day and night. Yes, I go to him in prayer, and he knows every care. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us tell him all about our trouble. He will hear our faintest cry.
And
he will you'll answer by and by. Now when you feel the prayer will turn in, and you'll know the fire's burning, you will find a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all about our troubles, and he will hear our faintest cry, and he will answer by and by. Now when you feel the prayer will turn in, and you'll know the fire's burning, you find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
I may have doubts and fears, my eyes be filled with tears, but Jesus is a friend who watches day and night. I go to him in prayer, he knows my everywhere, and just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all about our troubles, and he will hear our faintest cry. He will answer by and by. Now when you feel the prayer will turn in, and you know the fire is burning, you will find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Well, alright. Just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Alright.
Just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Now let us have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us tell him all about our troubles, and he will hear our faintest cry. And he will answer by and by. Now when you feel the prayer will turn in, then you'll know the fire is burning, you find a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all about our troubles, and he will hear our faintest cry. And he will answer by and by. Now when you feel the prayer will turn in, then you'll know the fire is burning, find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. God is so good. Amen. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, we praise and worship you tonight. Oh, because of who you are. Hallelujah. Oh, you've done so much for me, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Because of you. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Jehovah Jireh, you're my provider. Jehovah Nissi, Lord, you reign in victory. Jehovah Shalom, you are my Prince of Peace. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Jehovah Nissi, Lord, you reign in victory. Jehovah Shalom, you are my Prince of Peace. And I worship you because of who you are. Jehovah Shalom, my provider. Jehovah Shalom, you are my Prince of Peace. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise.
I give you praise.
Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Jehovah Nissi, Lord, to reign in victory. Jehovah Shalom, you are my Prince of Peace. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Jehovah Nissi, Lord, you reign in victory. Jehovah Shalom, you are my Prince of Peace. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you just because of who you are. I will worship you because of who you are.
Hallelujah. Can we just take time and do that tonight? Oh, before you're seated, go ahead. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for who you are tonight. Amen. Aren't you glad you know who Jesus is tonight? Amen. Shake a neighbor's hand as you're seated this evening. We again want to welcome you to our fifth Sunday night community service. What a joy it is to have all the churches and pastors with us. And we will take time maybe to recognize some of those pastors later on in service tonight. Just make yourself at home. If this is not where you're usually at on Sunday night, we'll call it your home tonight. Make yourself at home while you're here, and we're delighted to have you with us on campus. Just before our youth choir comes to sing for you tonight, I asked them if they would redo a skit. It's not on the service outline that we presented to the leadership, but I've asked them to redo a 4 or 5 minute skit that they did this morning that was just very impactful. And so right after this skit, the youth choir will be coming, but let's take care of this first, and if they're ready, they can come on and do that. It's simply entitled, The Stool.
No. Well, first of all, I also know, but more importantly, I also know, and you don't want me to make all the decisions.
I know, but think about it. I have to go with him. This is my best friend. I have to do this with her.
You can do it, but you can have a school bag too.
No, that's not how I want it to be. I want you to have a school. I want you to make the decisions. Okay, so I will tell her that I can't go because I just don't think it's right. Okay, so this is not all over. I'm sorry. I'll make it right. I promise. I'll do it. Hey, how you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. So, I have an idea.
Okay, what is it?
You know my grandma, right?
Yeah, you know mommy Karen?
Yeah.
Yeah. She's awesome, love her.
Alright, so, you know the old people, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I'm assuming they're going to be with her. And they're all down.
Yeah, they have actually no story.
Yeah, no. Not at all. So, I have an idea. We should have a spa day.
Yes, they were off the spa. That'd be awesome. Yeah.
So I think we should bring a spa to the event.
Yeah. Bring a spa to the event. How do you want to
know? Like, so, you know my grandma, she's got them big toenails.
Yeah.
Look how deep you are.
Oh my goodness.
And then, like, under that dandruff.
Oh, my word.
I love that girl.
Oh, my goodness.
I'm covering, like, the same.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Good evening.
Yeah. Did I say anything?
What do you mean?
I think we should start
it. Oh, I can't do that. Hold on. I can't. You know, you got to check in more than a minute. Next time, I'm just way too busy with my ass. I have to get that out there.
What about Wednesday?
Wednesday, even worse. I can't do it. I have this big old chance to study for it, and, you know, church that night, and I just can't do it.
Next month, is it?
Next month? No, I'm too busy.
Well, call me and let me know.
I'll let you know. It's going to be sometime in the way, way too busy. We got so much going on right now. It's not, yeah. But I'll let you know for sure.
Alright.
Alright, see y'all later.
Alright. Chad, I just don't think it's working out.
Well, how did this happen?
Like, I said yes.
Okay, but that just doesn't make sense to me.
It doesn't matter if it makes sense to you.
I can't do it. Like, you know about emo cars and creams in the hair and that kind of rough little bit. And imagine if I were to get there and get to see all the elderly. That would not be good. Like, that's probably the big crowd. And then they'd be even less joyful.
I said yes. So if you want me to say so, you gotta listen to me.
Oh my goodness, okay. So you're telling me that I have to call him and go with him?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I can't do it on Sunday because, you know, you gotta have that afternoon nap.
Okay.
But I'll try to do it Wednesday. So go ahead, sit back down. I'm sorry. Let's start over.
Fresh start.
Yes, fresh start. Yes. Yes.
So, tell me about that $50 you stole from your mom.
That $50?
Yeah.
How much did you come from? What happened?
Well, it's kind of hard to forget. You stole it this morning.
This morning? That $50. Okay.
Well,
here's the deal. She doesn't really need that $50. Not like you go shopping all the time. And she doesn't need that $50. But I do because, you know, I have things to do.
That doesn't matter. Like, that's her money.
I know, but I'll put it back before she even knows it's gone.
It doesn't matter. That's stealing.
Stealing.
I made a decision that I'm giving it back to her.
But if I can't just go tell her that, I'll be in trouble.
It doesn't matter what you think you're going to get in trouble for. I don't know. But I say you're going to give it back to her. If you want me to sell your stealing, that's what you're
doing. Oh, my goodness. But I can't do that.
Okay.
I can't do that.
I just don't. I don't think it's working out. Well, you gave me the sword, but you keep taking it back.
I don't want to take it back. I thought a decision would be a lot. I thought your decision would be a lot like my decision.
Well, apparently not. So you gotta make a decision. But you gave me the sword, you didn't give me the sword.
Well, I can't just take the sword back.
Okay, give it to me.
But I've tried to do that. It obviously ain't working.
Well, you have to make a choice.
Well, I've been trying to make a choice.
You have to make a choice.
I can't.
Just do it.
Something so simple, but full of deep message. And you won't do it tonight, but how many of you are having a duty of giving God the stool and then saying, God, do it my will. Amen. That not only bless you, but it blessed you too. It blessed you too. Time. God, God, that people in the trust. $50 All right, how do you buy
to do what he's called me to do. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Anyone's ever seen the mountain of their sin just disappear? Anyone's ever felt the hand of heaven reach down to their fear and dry their tears? For any life once empty now finds itself alive and full of songs, victory songs. Then you'll understand the reason for the way the saints of God may carry on.
If I shout, Lord, I shout from a heart that's been washed clear. From the past that's been redeemed, to the world and not the crazy, there's just no telling what you're gonna do. And I'm only Jesus here to hold you. If I'm shouting, oh I'm shouting, from a heart that's been washed with my blood, no I'm running. They've got a future and a hope beyond the grave. Every life's a different story. How he led us out of darkness and into light. There's no way to keep us silent. Every breath's another chance to testify.
Yeah.
How many of you are glad when Jesus got a hold of you? Amen. No telling what you're going to do. The Lord touches your life. Amen. I'm going to ask the ushers to go ahead and get ready to wait upon you tonight. Give you an opportunity to worship in your giving. Now, offerings tonight, our general offerings, will be going to the expenses of this event, our advertisement, and the honorarium for our guest speaker. If you're part of the local church and you need to put your tithes in, you go ahead and do that. The office will know what to do with those. But general offerings tonight will all be accounted and sent from my office to Pastor Matthew's office as we want to cover the expenses. I love these times that we get together. Amen. Whether it's here or over at Violin Road, wherever it's at, it's good to be a part of the family of God. And I'm thankful for that tonight. Father, we love you tonight. Thank you for the privilege that we have of being in the house of the Lord tonight. God, today, tonight in this service, there's not different churches. There's just one family, brothers and sisters that have come together to lift up the name of Jesus. I pray as we give of this offering that you'll bless it for its intended use, meet the needs of the expenses of this meeting, and we will forever be grateful for it. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody said amen. Amen and amen. God bless you as you give tonight.
God, it's a pleasure to be here tonight with you. Our church, we just love these moments when we get together. We call this our extended family. We just come together and amen, we just worship the Lord together, amen. Just enjoying, amen, what we felt so far, amen. Don't you love this? This is wonderful, and believing, amen, for amen, many more great things tonight. Amen. I want Brother Malcolm to come, amen. He's going to share a song with you tonight, amen. I just know that he's a blessing to us, and no doubt he'll be a blessing to you this evening, amen. So I'm believing tonight, amen, when the brother gets to speak, I just want to soak up, amen, all that he has tonight, and I just believe the Lord's going to move in this place. So let's just continue to worship, amen. None of us has come here to be entertained. None of us has come to sit and listen, but we've come to, amen, get in and listen to the Word of God. And when I believe that songs are sermons set to music, you believe that with me? Songs are sermons set to music tonight. So I believe this evening, brother's going to come and share a song with us, amen. Let's worship as he sings tonight.
I'd like to give you a little something before I sing. I've been doing some study on Bible prophecy, and I ran across something the other day that kind of shocked me a little bit. And let me say this here. I want all Christians, check your Christian, your heavenly bank account. Check it over real close, and I'll tell you why in a minute. 1942, there were 15 high German officials gathered in Berlin. And there were the Third Reich's group. At that meeting, they came together and they came up with the extermination camps in Germany. Through that, there were 6 million European Jews were exterminated. 45, Soviet Union came in and liberated them. There were 5 million left. Just here recently, there's been 70 nations have come together, and they've passed a thing now. They want to split Israel again. So about your bank account, check it. Make sure that you're paid up, prayed up, and ready to go up. High upon the mountain, from where he ascended, an angel of the Lord said that it would be. He said, don't stand here grieving for the one that you see leaving, in like manner coming back for you and me. And I believe he's coming back like he said. I believe that the trumpet's gonna sound so loud, one day it'll wake the dead. In the twinkling of an eye, he'll split the eastern sky. I believe he's coming back like he said. I believe the time is nearing when we'll soon see his appearing, and this could be the hour. Yes, this could be the day when the saints from all the nations will lose their gravitation in the middle of the air, be called away. And I believe he's coming back like he said. I believe that the trumpet's gonna sound so loud, one day it'll wake the dead. In the twinkling of an eye, he'll split the eastern skies. And I believe he's coming back like he said. I believe he's coming back like he said. I believe that the trumpet's gonna sound so loud, one day it'll wake the dead. In the twinkling of an eye, he'll split the eastern sky. And I believe he's coming back like he said. In the twinkling of an eye, he'll split the eastern skies. I believe he's coming back like he said.
Jesus, I love those old songs like that. My mom and dad used to sing that. A long time since I heard that song, and it's so true. You know, I'm looking forward to that day whenever Jesus Christ does call us home. You know, this place, it offers some comforts and things like that, but man, I just look forward to heaven so much. For everybody that does not know me, I'm Pastor Dustin. I'm the youth pastor here. I have the privilege of serving underneath Brother Thomas. And it's a joy. I tell you what, we have a great youth group to work with. And, you know, I try to teach them something every once in a while, but boy, they teach me stuff. And the other day, you know, I was kind of humble Friday night. You know, the guys come up to me and say, hey, can we pray for you? I'm like, oh, man. Absolutely. You know, just it's so exciting. Our drama team is trying to get ready right now. We're going to do one more drama for you this afternoon. And I thank God for moving this morning through this drama. I do want to, I've got a lot of new people here tonight, so I do want to warn you, there is some pretty graphic scenes in this drama. It's real. And it's a lot of what, you know, young adults, older adults, it don't matter what your age is, teenagers, they go through this stuff. And we're bringing it to life. And, you know, I'm looking forward to what they're going to do. And any moment, Jesus is going to walk out the door. And I'm trying to wait for him right at the moment. But if you would, put your hands together for our drama team.
Where I've that will set us free, power that will break the chains of bondage. Amen. Amen. Again, welcome to our fifth Sunday night service, our community service. It is a joy for us to have with us several folks from the Apopka Park Avenue Worship Center. And Violin Road is here. Are there any other churches that are here that I haven't met you yet tonight? All right. So great turnout from Violin Road. Great turnout from Apopka. I'm thankful for all the home folks of Ocoee that come tonight. And we asked Brother Larry Bauckham, the pastor, Bishop Bauckham, the pastor of Park Avenue, to come and bring the word tonight. He and Sister Melanie are doing a wonderful job. We were with them back in November, and they let me come preach one night over there. Had a wonderful time. And I contacted him. Brother Chester and I were talking, and he said, we'll come. And he said, I may bring a few folks with me too. And they turned out good tonight to support their pastor. Amen. And Brother Bauckham, we love you. Love Sister Melody. We're delighted that you're here tonight. Don't worry about time. Okay? We've done all of that. We've got time for the Word. Amen? I know this man of God has something for us tonight, and I want to just give him as much time as he needs, because all of that has been done to prepare our hearts to the receiving of the Word. And then after that Word is preached, then it's time for us to gather around this altar and let God do some changing, some stirring, and drawing us closer. So Bishop, you come. Would you make Brother Bauckham welcome as he comes to this pulpit tonight to minister the word of the Lord.
Amen. Everybody glad to be in the house of the Lord tonight. We have been in the house of the Lord all day. It's been wonderful. We had a great service this morning. The Lord has really been moving. I was talking to someone before service. It just seems the last 6 months at Park Avenue, things of the Holy Spirit just seems to have taken things to a new level. And it's always tempting to take some credit for that. But you always know it's nothing you've done except being obedient and looking for the opportunities that God gives you. I'm so thankful that he's given us an opportunity here and to minister, to get to know each of you a little bit better. We had a dinner afterwards, just a little celebration. I ate too much and it was a little too salty. Do you have a water that I could get? I appreciate it very much. I ate too much and I'm not used to all of that salt and everything, and so I don't want to be any drier than it has to be tonight. But so glad that you're here tonight. I was thinking that song, Just a Little Talk with Jesus. That's one of my favorites. The backstory, I don't know all the details, but I know it was a man in Chattanooga, Tennessee, was working, I believe, during the Depression. Found a job at a movie theater, cleaning up the floors of the movie theater after the patrons had gone home. And he was on his last dime, had no money to pay his bills, no money to take care of his family, no money to do the things that he felt were necessary to do. And his heart was broken. And he began to cry out to the Lord in that movie theater, mopping those floors, sweeping up after those patrons. And as he got done, he found a $5 bill, which at that time was a lot more than $5 is today. And it got him through that difficult time. It got him through a time, and he wrote that song. It reminded him of that time when just a little talk with Jesus made all things right unexpectedly. And the sentiment is still as strong and the same today as it has ever been. Just a little talk with Jesus, no matter what we're going through, meets our needs. I'm so thankful for that tonight. Brother Tony, you recognize the pastor plays the piano at that other church as well. You saw that, didn't you? I'm taking piano lessons, and they like to give me a little bit of a hard time about it because I haven't actually played a song yet. That was wonderful. Such a wonderful time of worship tonight. So glad to see Hazel Baldry walk in. We've known each other for more than many people in my life, and Vernon as well. I pastored them in Orlando for a number of years while we were there. A wonderful family, had a great time with them, and so glad that they're here with us tonight as well. Turn in your Bibles to Deuteronomy chapter 32. I want to talk about disturbances tonight. Has anybody ever been disturbed? But did you know there are divine disturbances as well? There are things that God either brings in our lives or allows in our lives for purposes of spiritual growth. Now, I love the Lord with all of my heart. I love to be in services like this one. very comfortable with people that we know and we trust and we appreciate and that love one another and that are glad to be here. But there are times in my Christian life where I've made plans and they didn't go the way I intended them to go. There were times when I believed with all of my heart that I was doing it for the right reasons. I was serving God, and I believed that the Holy Spirit had led me somewhere. And at the end of the day, it didn't work out the way I thought it should work out. And one of the things I want to share with the young people today is that you will probably fail at some point in your life. If I were to take a poll of all of those over the age of 30 tonight and ask how many of you have failed at some point in your life, I imagine I would get 100% of the honest people to respond that I've failed at some point in my life. And then there are those other times when there were feelings of failure. And I'm here to tell you that while disobedience and willfully going against God's plan is never okay, it's okay to look back and recognize that failure led to something that God had for me. And if I had not failed, I may not be in the place that God wants me to be to accomplish the ministry that He's given me in my heart. Moses was a man who knew what failure was. Deuteronomy chapter 32 reminds us of the relationship that we have with God and how He brings disturbance in our life sometimes. Beginning in verse number 9, chapter 32, it says, "For the Lord's portion is His people Jacob. His people Jacob is the lot of His inheritance. He found him in a desert land and in the waste, howling wilderness. He led him about. He instructed him. He kept him as the apple of His eye. As an eagle stirreth up her nest, fluttereth over her young, spreadeth abroad her wings, taketh them, beareth them on her wings, so the Lord alone did lead him, and there was no strange God with him. He made him ride on the high places of the earth, that he might eat the increase of the fields, and he made him to suck honey out of the rock and oil out of the flinty rock. Butter of kine and milk of sheep with fat of lambs and rams of the breed of Bashan and goats with the fat of kidneys of wheat, and thou didst drink the pure blood of the grape." Father, we come before You. Lord, I believe that a Kohi has experienced divine disturbances. I believe that Park Avenue Worship Center has experienced divine disturbances. Lord, it's wonderful the things that You're doing in our midst. It's wonderful the lives that are being changed. But Father, we can never become so comfortable that we don't recognize there is still a lost and dying world that needs to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Help us, Father, to respond to Your calling. Help us to accommodate, dear Lord, all that which You have called us to, that we might walk in obedience. Many might see and call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. Lord, we give You the praise and the glory and the honor. Ask Your blessings over Your word for the next few moments in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Remind of the old country song that says, "If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all." There are times in my life where it seemed like things would go, you thought it had gotten as bad as it could get, and then things took a turn for the worse. I'm not talking about being outside of a relationship with Jesus Christ. I'm talking about your plans going nowhere, and you're in church on every Sunday morning. You're on your knees in the morning throughout the week. You're in the Word. You're doing what you believe God has called you to do, and yet nothing seems to be going your way. And we cry out to God, and sometimes in our own minds or even in a moment of great honesty with someone else, we might ask, "Is it worth it?" I'm here to tell you it's worth it tonight. No matter what the disturbance may be, if we are God's children, we recognize that the disturbances, the places of conflict in our lives are not there for no purpose. They're not there to harm us. They're not there to that the world might make fun of us. They are there that we might have a greater relationship with God and a greater opportunity to share His love with others. Moses, writing here in the 32nd chapter of Deuteronomy, expresses the relationship that we have with the Lord as a mother eagle with her eaglets. And it says she stirreth the nest. Now that meant nothing to me before I did a little bit of research. It just seemed like the mother was kind of kicking up some dust or something. But the idea here is that the eaglets that are in the nest are very comfortable where they are. The mother eagle has done a great job of providing a comfortable home for these young chicks. And so as they begin to grow, she's gotten all kinds of twigs and things to put the nest together. She's lined that nest with all kinds of soft things. She's taken some feathers and some leaves and some other things that she's found around. She's gone down and gotten some lint from your dryer vent that back in the backyard. She's gotten a few things from here and there, and she's made a very comfortable nest for the eaglets to live in. But there comes a time when the eaglets have to leave the nest. And so to do that, what she does is she begins to stir the nest. She begins to take those areas of comfort in those young birds' life, and she begins to simply remove them or rearrange them in such a way that the eaglets become uncomfortable, and sooner or later they begin to topple out of the nest. Now, the idea here is that we think, well, at this time, the eaglets will spread their wings and they will fly, but that's not the case. That's not what the Bible is saying here. The eaglets begin to fall from the nest to the earth, 100 or more feet, and they're floundering around. They're trying to spread their wings, but they haven't got to that point yet where they can fly on their own. And so as they begin to head toward the ground, at the last moment, the mother eagle swoops in and saves them from hitting the ground. They don't know she's going to be there at the last possible moment. They don't understand why this mother, who's provided so much comfort for them up to this point, is taking away those comforts. And in their little bird minds, they may be thinking, is it worth it? As they topple over the side and plunge toward the earth. But they have a good mother who saves them at the last moment. I want to tell you, if God is stirring the nest in your life, if there's a disturbance in your life, there's a purpose and a reason for why He's doing that, that we might be better at what He's called us to be. I thank God for the crowd that's out tonight. I thank God for the work that He's doing in so many lives. That I mentioned a moment ago, and it's been on my heart at Apopka as well, is that there is a world outside of our doors that needs to hear about Jesus Christ. And we've made very comfortable facilities. I'm so thankful that our facilities are comfortable. I thank God for air conditioning. That man that invented air conditioning, I hope he died a rich man. Amen? But if we become so comfortable inside the four walls of our church that we never take the message of Jesus Christ outside the four walls of the church, then we are not living in the place that God wants us to be. I want us to see three things very quickly that God is wanting us to understand about what He does that we might deal with these divine disturbances. And there's three questions I want us to ask. The first question is, are we recognizing God's dealings with us? Are we responding appropriately to those dealings? And thirdly, and possibly the most difficult, is are we rejoicing in the difficulties that God brings into our lives? First thing that we see is that you must recognize God's dealing in your life. I thank God for salvation. You know, when you are preaching the message, and you give the altar call, and it may just be one lost sinner that comes. It doesn't matter if it's one or 1,000 that come down. I promise you, the exuberation in a minister's heart when that lost soul comes to Jesus Christ is just the same as if you're preaching to a stadium and 1,000 come down, because you know the angels in heaven are rejoicing over one lost soul that comes to Jesus Christ. But if we're not careful, what happens is we never get past the initial exuberance of salvation. We keep coming back to the same place. We keep reliving the same event over and over again. And we're glad we got saved. But the concern for others' salvation never begins to enter into our heart. I believe that God is dealing with Moses here, and by extension dealing with the people of God, that'd be us tonight. That at some point we have to get off the place where we simply are living in remembrance of the salvation in our life and begin sharing that salvation with somebody else. It's a gift that's been given to us that we might pass it on. We might re-gift it to someone else. I'm looking for the opportunity to re-gift that gift of salvation in someone's life, but we have to recognize God's dealings in our life. I love the skit about Jesus up here on the stool. Who played Jesus? You played Jesus. Jesus does not wear a gator's bow tie. I just want to remind everybody about that. Other than that, it was a great skit. But I love the idea that we hand Jesus the power to our lives. All of us today, if I were to take a poll and say, stand up if you give Jesus the power, all of us would stand up and we'd raise our hands. But tomorrow, when you're at work and things aren't going the way you want them to go, and it's easier to pass it off to somebody else than take responsibility yourself, I don't preach at you because I'm pointing fingers. I preach at you because I've been there myself. Are we going to stand up for what's right and give God the glory in our life and let Him tell us how we're supposed to handle that situation? Or are we going to keep on doing things our way, making the same mistakes we've always made, trying to squeak our way into heaven rather than going triumphantly through those gates, rejoicing with those who we led to Jesus Christ along the way? I want a parade when I get to heaven. Not for me, for Jesus. I want a parade of all of those that somewhere along the line I sowed a seed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That somewhere along the way I was able to water that seed that someone else had planted. Or maybe somewhere that God gave me the great privilege of being a part of that harvest of that soul and bring him to a relationship with Jesus Christ. I don't want to go alone to eternity. We've got to understand that God deals with us in many different ways. We talked this morning about the Passover. In the Passover, they put the blood on the lintel, and they put the blood on the right post, and they put the blood on the left post. And as the death angel went by, he didn't see the people inside the house. He saw the sign of the cross, the lintel, the head, and the right and the left. The cross, the blood of Jesus Christ, even the Old Testament, was shown there. He deals with us in the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. If God did not keep his own son, the Bible reminds us, how much is he going to ask of us? Jesus Christ had to give up heaven for our salvation. It's not that God's asking us to sacrifice. I was talking about this morning as well. We think we sacrifice. But when I get to the other side of it, when I recognize what God's doing, I recognize I didn't sacrifice anything. God blessed me through my obedience and gave me more than I ever gave up. And so if you want to have the relationship with Jesus Christ that brings you to that place where no longer are you struggling to get by, but you are gloriously redeemed in Jesus Christ, give God what he desires. Give God what he requires of you, and God will give you back so much more. We must recognize God's dealings because they are beneficial to us. We must recognize God's dealings with us because they are beneficial to others as well. I have a 19-year-old son. I pray for that boy all the time. I tell you, I would not go back and be 19 for all the money in the world. You could not pay me enough to be 19 again. I wake up in the morning with my aches and pains, and I say, thank God I'm not 19. But if I'm not serving God the way I'm supposed to be serving God, who's going to pray for him? Well, there may be some that love him, but they don't love him like I love him. His mama prays for him constantly. If she's not doing what she needs to be doing, who's going to love him like Mama loves him? But as at the end of our prayer, we always remind ourselves that there's someone who loves our son more than we do. It took me a long time to come to that understanding, that God wants more for Connor than I want for Connor. God wants to bless Connor in ways I can't bless Connor. But it means I've got to begin recognizing the dealings of God in my life and become obedient in every aspect, that salvation might come not just to me but my household also, the New Testament tells me. I believe that we can pray salvation for our children, and God's Holy Spirit will knock down every possible wall that they can erect. Now, they have to make the decision, church. Understand, they've got to come to Jesus Christ on their own volition. I can't save Connor any more than anybody else outside of Jesus Christ and His Holy Spirit can. But I can pray, and I can believe, and I can be obedient. The Holy Spirit of God knock those walls down, soften that heart, chip away at it, do whatever is necessary that he might find that place in Jesus Christ that he wants him to be. We've got to understand that the dealings that God brings into our life, change is always difficult for us. The people of Israel were going through changes. They had been 400 years in slavery in Egypt. We're awful hard on the people of Israel as they go through the wilderness, but I want to tell you that human beings are human beings, and we would have complained about the same way they complained. They're a few days out in the wilderness. They've eaten up all of their stores. Everything they brought with them out of Egypt, they've eaten up. They go to Moses and say, "Why in the world did you bring us out here, the desert? Weren't there enough graves in Egypt for us? At least we had fish in Egypt." I always think you were slaves in Egypt. If we're not careful, we begin to look back on our lives before Christ and we go, "Well, at least we had fish back there. But we were slaves to sin. I would rather starve to death as a Christian than eat the fish of my sinful nature." We've got to understand that God does not keep us from good things simply to keep them from us. He keeps us from those things because they are not as beneficial as we once thought they were. When we begin to deal with the areas that God is dealing with, we begin to see the work that the Holy Spirit desires to do in our life. Second thing that I see is that we must understand how to respond to God's dealings in our life. Look how these eaglets learned to fly. First of all, there had to be a commitment. They had to leave the nests. It's wonderful to go around and know that the Holy Spirit of God is with us at all times. But what that means is he's not just here in this service on Sunday night. He's in my car as I'm traveling down the highway at no more than 70 miles an hour, of course. The Holy Spirit can't go more than 70 miles an hour. Remember that. But the Holy Spirit goes with me everywhere. I don't have to come. Now, I love coming to church services like this. I love getting together with God's people and hearing your testimony and how God's worked in your life and praying with you over the desires and the difficulties you're going through. But how wonderful it is when we get out in the world and the world sees things one way, but all of a sudden the Holy Spirit of God puts those glasses on us, those salvation glasses. And all of a sudden we begin to see things a little differently than the world begins to see them. And all of a sudden we begin to rejoice in the midst of difficulty and circumstances we don't understand. I remember a man I pastored, he lost his son at 20 years of age, found him murdered. In the midst of that awful time in their life, I can't imagine the difficulty he was going through. Through the tears of sorrow, he would begin to weep and praise the name of Jesus Christ. And people around him began to ask him, "Why are you praising God in this situation?" He says, "Because if it hadn't been for the grace of Jesus Christ in my life, he had never been in my life in the first place." You see, our perspective makes so much difference in our life. If we come from a perspective that everything is bad and everything is against us and there is no joy in anything that we do, then we will always be joyless. If we come from the perspective that God has blessed us abundantly, that God wants more than just what we have in the joy of the Lord today, but a joy that is unspeakable, a joy full of His glory, a joy that says there's no way that it could get better than this, and then it does. See, that's the God that we serve, but we have to make that commitment that we're going to get out of the nest of our comfort and begin to allow ourselves to fall into the hands of an almighty God. We've got to respond to what God is doing in our life. First, there comes the commitment. Then there comes a confidence. Think about that young eaglet. As the mother eagle is watching from her perch, seeing if this is going to be the time that the eaglet finally spreads its wings and flies for the first time. The eagle's still ready to catch the eaglet at a moment's notice. Never outside the love and concern of that mother eagle. But imagine that eaglet spreads its wings for the first time. All of a sudden, that fall is stabilized for just a second. Suddenly, they're no longer plunging to earth, but they're beginning gliding through the air. And that first time, they beat those wings and the power of the wings that they beat. And they recognize there's a power within them they did not recognize before. We call ourselves Pentecostal, don't we still? We still do, right? I'm just checking. Because sometimes, and I'm as guilty as anybody, I'm a modern American Pentecostal. We talk about the power, but we don't experience the power. A lot of times we are willing to make the commitment to fall out of the nest, but all we do is fall until God catches us again. God does not want us to fall out of the nest over and over again just because we've gotten into the routine of falling out of the nest. He wants us to fall out of the nest that we might recognize there's a power within us that we did not recognize before. That we can begin to spread our wings that the Holy Spirit of God has empowered us to spread. And we can begin to flap the powerful wings that God has given to us. And we no longer have to fall to the ground to all those difficulties and problems we fall into time and time again. But we can begin to soar as eagles. Because of the power of the Holy Spirit of God. How do we respond? Our response is so important. Do we spread our wings and trust in God, not just to catch us when we fall, but spread our wings to lead us in the power of the Holy Spirit to accomplish great things for Jesus Christ? I look at a church of in Ocoee, and I look at the other church, and you're in Ocoee as well, and the church in Apopka. How much can we accomplish, just we who are here in this sanctuary tonight, for the power of Jesus Christ through His Holy Spirit? We'll stop just falling, and we'll begin to spread our wings and flap them in the power of the Holy Spirit and soar on wings of eagles. The third thing, last thing, I'll go very quickly here. Probably the most difficult thing. You must rejoice in God's dealings. I'm old enough when I remember when I did something wrong, and suddenly my dad got that look on his face. I knew exactly what that look meant. We could be in the middle of a crowded mall or church or anywhere else, and all my dad had to do was look at me. I knew what that meant. I mean, as soon as we got home, I was going to go to his bedroom, and I was going to pick out the belt with which he was going to extract the punishment for what I had done. And I knew better than to get one of those flimsy cloth belts, because that meant he got to pick the belt after that. It meant I was going to have some discipline, because I'd done something wrong. Now, not one time in my entire childhood did I get that look and say, thank God my dad caught me at what I'm doing and I get a spanking when I get home. Not once. I know you find that hard to believe. Not once did I rejoice in the discipline my father brought to my life. But I began to get older. I began to recognize the great love that my dad had for me. that he wasn't willing for me to go off and do things my own way when he knew that it was harmful for me and harmful to those around me, and eventually it could lead to death. So I began to rejoice that my dad loved me that much. Now we grow up. My dad no longer has that same kind of authority in my life where he disciplines me in that way. But I serve a heavenly Father who still disciplines me from time to time. And as a Christian, I can be that childish. You understand there's a difference between childlike and childish, right? God has called us to be childlike. No unchildlike person, non-childlike, childlikeless, I don't know. But no person who's not childlike, the Bible tells us, will enter into the kingdom of heaven. It's impossible. Unless you have a childlike faith, you cannot enter in God's kingdom. But I want to tell you very clearly, no childish person will enter in as well. Because I've met some 55, 65, 75-year-old childish people. God's saying, how are we going to respond? How are we going to do these things? We're going to rejoice in the dealings that God has with us. When we do something wrong and God corrects us, praise God. When things don't go the way that we want them to go, recognize it wasn't supposed to go that way anyway, or in Jesus Christ it would have gone that way. Praise God. When all of a sudden that child isn't doing what they're supposed to do and you've got to discipline them and it hurts you more than it hurts me. I never understood that till I got my own son. Praise God that he's given you the opportunity to mold that young person into someone that can one day look back and be thankful for the parents that they've been given that discipline them in the difficult times. In all things, the Bible says, give thanks. That's how we deal with what God brings into our life. The musicians could come and play. In Exodus chapter 19, verse 4, the Bible gives us another example of God's dealing with Israel. Says, you have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bare you on eagle's wings, and brought you unto myself. God's desire for every single human being on the face of planet Earth is that they might fall out of the nest of comfort, out of the cult of comfort that we've become so enamored with in our modern, especially American culture. And we fall into his arms, and he bears us up as wings of eagles. He carries us across the difficult times. When there seems to be an impassable gorge, God seems to miraculously carry us across because he has that power in our lives. I don't know what news you're dealing with this week. I know at our church we've got those who are dealing with doctors who say they've got cancer. I can't imagine what your heart must do sitting in the doctor's office and saying it's malignant. You've been praying, you've been having the church pray, and yet the word that comes from the knowledgeable, educated professional in front of you says it's cancer. Sometimes they say, oh, well, this is what we can do. Sometimes they say there's nothing we can do. Bible tells me in that circumstance, thank God. Maybe you're in a situation where your job is in jeopardy. You don't know where the money's going to come from. You've been serving God for years. You know all the scriptures that talk about the benefits. You've been a faithful tithe payer. Your church has benefited because of you being a member here. God's not forgotten you. Praise God in that situation as well. Maybe you're in a relationship. That relationship isn't going the way that you want it to go. that person on the other side of the relationship doesn't respond to what God is doing in their life the way they ought to. This is probably the most difficult thing for us to understand, is that by giving God glory, by thanking God in the midst of every circumstance, we are a witness to those who are closest to us. Anybody have unsaved loved ones here tonight? I have an unsaved brother. Breaks my heart. He grew up in the church, loved God, sang in the youth choir. Somewhere along the line, he took that stool back. Decided he was going to do it his way. My family prays for him and his family. We pray that we would be witnesses. We pray that somehow what we say will get, and yet every time we get together, it doesn't seem like enough. It seems like I want to do more. God's dealing with me. He's saying, you know what? If you're doing everything I've asked you to do, you're doing enough. Praise me. Glorify me that your brother might see. Glorify me that he might know that you serve me. That no matter what, I'm going to be enough for you. If you'd stand with me all over this place tonight. What do we do with God dealing with us tonight? If we're going to be victorious, we must praise Him. I'm going to ask you to do something that's going to be difficult for some of you. For those of you who came here in need, maybe it's one of those needs I mentioned just a moment ago. But I'm not going to ask you to just come down these altars and say a little prayer. Go home tonight. I don't believe that's God's will for us. I believe God created us for a singular purpose. He created us that we might glorify Him. If God's dealing with you tonight, if the Holy Spirit is calling you, He's calling you that you might glorify Him here in this place tonight. He's setting the stage for this week that whatever you're going to go through is going to be covered in the praise of Jesus Christ. That praise is going to go with you throughout this week. That when that difficult coworker begins to make trouble, the praise of Jesus Christ will be on your lips because it began tonight. When you go home to that spouse, that unsaved loved one, and the enemy says that it's never going to happen, they're never going to get saved, you're going to praise God for their salvation because it began here tonight. When that bill comes in and you look at the checkbook and there's not enough money to cover the bill, you're going to be able to recognize your Heavenly Father's got an account for you. He's already meeting that need. And you can praise God because it began here tonight. God's dealing with you in that way. I want you to step out from where you are. I want us to praise God in these altars tonight. There's someone tonight says, Pastor, I want to praise God with you. Join me here in these altars right now. Somebody that wants to be free from the burden that the enemy is bringing, join me in these altars and praise God with me. Don't let me praise God on my own tonight. Join with me. Whatever the difficulty, whatever the trial, whatever the dealings, that when the Holy Spirit begins to stir the nest and we fall over the side, that we know it's with purpose and reason that God's brought us to that point. We might praise God. Thank you, Lord. Praise your holy name. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. I need you more.
Oh, Holy Spirit.
More than yesterday, I need you more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord. Yesterday, I need you more. So much more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you more. I need you more than the air I breathe. More than the song I sing, more than the next heartbeat. Oh, more than anything. And Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never want to go back to my old life. I need you more. Oh, I need you. More than yesterday, I need you more. Oh, so much more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you more. I need you more than the air I breathe. More than the song I sing, and more than the next heartbeat. Oh, more than anything. And Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never wanna go back to my old life. I need you more. Oh, I need you. More than yesterday, I need you more.
Hallelujah.
So much more than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you more. I need you more. I need you more than yesterday. I need you more. Thank you, Jesus. More than words can say. I need you more than ever before. I need you more. I need you more than the air I breathe, more than the song I sing. More than the next heartbeat. More than anything. And Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never want to go back to my old life. I need you more. I need you more. More than yesterday, I need you more. More than words can say. I need you more than ever before.
need you more. Surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Just let your presence fill this place. Oh, surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Oh, surround me, oh Lord. Just let your presence this place. Oh, surround me, oh Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, surround me, oh Lord. Oh, surround me, oh Lord. Oh, just let your presence fill this place. Oh, surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Oh, surround me, oh Lord. Oh, just let your presence fill this place. Oh, surround.
Well, before we dismiss tonight, would you just lift your hands toward heaven? Simple chorus, you should know it already. If not, listen to your neighbor. Let's just spend a few moments giving praise and honor and glory unto the one who sits high above the throne tonight. Oh God, that you are the heavens and the
earth. Oh, just let your presence fill this place. Oh, surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Just let your presence.
Well, let's sing it one more time tonight. Surround us with your presence.
Surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Surround me, oh Lord. Just let your presence
fill. Hallelujah. Father, we're thankful tonight for who you are. Thankful, Lord, that you care about us, Lord. And God, when it seems we have fallen out of the nest, your Spirit is there to catch us, Lord, to lead us, and let us to not leave this place with a different perspective tonight. Let us not, God, leave looking for ways, Lord, not to always be caught by you, but to spread the wings of faith that you have given us, Lord, in our individual churches and in our individual families. Let us rise to the occasion, Lord, that we can share the love of Jesus with somebody who needs to know there is a God in heaven that loved them so much that he sent his son to die on Calvary for their sins. Help us, God, in all that we do. Give us trouble and mercy, Lord. Touch every church. Touch every pastor. Touch every minister. Lord, and just give us, Lord, more than we ever could imagine as we do things for the kingdom of God. And we will forever be grateful for it. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody said amen. Lord, would you give the Lord a hand clap of praise for who he is tonight? Oh, I like Sunday nights like this. Amen. Amen. They're going to sing while you fellowship with those around you. And if I don't see you back at the next quarterly meeting, I'll see you up in heaven. God bless you. You are dismissed tonight.